It seems that up until today, Washington's policies towards the Middle East and the former Soviet Union, especially Central Asia and the Caucasus, existed in a disconnect, meaning there was Iran was a Middle East power, and the former Soviet Union was something Eurasian, whatever that means, and as if these two policies were not connected. I think today's panels have definitely made a very clear point of how interconnected whatever happens between Washington and Tehran, whatever happens in Iran itself, is quite interconnected to Iran's neighbors, to both the in the Middle East, but also to the north in the former Soviet Union. I think another thing that's come out of the discussions today that there's quite wide consensus that if that tightrope walk succeeds between Tehran and Washington, definitely would be a dramatic change, not only for Iran's neighbors, but for Iran itself, for the regime itself. Probably the regime itself could not sustain, you know, the trade with America and interaction with America. But if it fails, and I think there's been a wide consensus today, Washington's going to need its close allies more than ever. And many of those close allies are in the South Caucasus, are in the Middle East, and they're quite concerned about this current trend in Washington's relations with Iran. So to address, we have an incredible panel here today. To address where those relations are going, we'll open with David Sanger from the New York Times. It probably could be one of the most insightful people to give us a view on where those relations are going. David?
Well, thank you very much. It's great to be back here at Georgetown. Thank you all. Thank you, Brenda, for the introduction, and Angela for inviting me here. It's wonderful to be among all of you. The good news, as you've heard all morning, is that there are actual real discussions taking place. And that's significant because it's something that President Obama was seeking at the beginning of the first term, and it got interrupted both by the uprising that came about from the elections in Iran in June of 2009, but it also got interrupted by the fact that you had a supreme leader who at the time was not prepared to engage in the negotiations. The concern right now is sort of twofold. The first is we don't know how much running room these negotiators have. We've seen cases in the past where deals, arrangements were made, particularly after the Geneva and Vienna talks in 2009, late 2009. And then it went back to Tehran, and it disappeared into that vast black hole of decision-making in the Iranian process. The second difficulty that we've got is that the problem of the Iranian nuclear program, which is only one part of the overall relationship with Iran, but the most important part to get resolved right away before the others come together, is now vastly bigger than it was just 5 years ago. In fact, when you think about the last time that we were dealing with President Rouhani when he was the nuclear negotiator, there were 164 centrifuges spinning in Iran. When he came back as president, there were 18,000. When he left as negotiator, Iran did not have enough material to make a single bomb, even if it did additional enrichment. It's now got enough for 5, 6, 7. And I thought that with just a couple of slides here, I would just sort of show you the dimensions of the problem. And it explains why it is that not only is a negotiation going to be tough, but speed is somewhat of the essence in all of this. Because the biggest concern that the Israelis and the Saudis have right now is that the negotiations will be used to drag things on. And in the process, more building will happen. And partly that depends on how much the Iranians show some restraint, suspend during the negotiations, and so forth. So this first slide simply shows you the pathway to a bomb, where you start with uranium mining and milling, uranium conversion. You go and you begin to enrich low-enriched uranium, move up to 20%, the medium enriched, of which they have a little less than a bomb's worth. And I said they have 5 or 6, it's of this lower enriched. And then they haven't taken these last 4 steps. And so there are sort of 2 objectives to the negotiations. The first objective is to get them to back off from some of these, American objective. And the second one is, of course, to make it so difficult that you'd have a lot of warning time, say a year or two, if they were ever to go race up into these. And while the official American position is, of course, still, if you ask officials with cameras running, what do they need to do? They say suspend enrichment, comply with all the UN resolutions, and so forth. In fact, it seems pretty likely that the United States would settle for something that kept them doing some enrichment at the 5% amount, but also had caps on how much they are producing. See if I can make this all work. As I said before, they've only taken those first four steps. The ones you see in blue have yet to be taken. But the first issue is how you deal with this 20% enrichment. And this is a graphic that Graham Allison at Harvard uses very often. And it shows, in football analogy, since we are, after all, on the Georgetown campus, that when you're at 5% enriched, you've made it to about the 30-yard line in terms of the amount of work you need to do. If you are 20% enriched, you're essentially at the 10-yard line, that the amount of additional enrichment it takes to get to a bomb is actually fairly small. And this isn't a question of politics. This is a question of physics. If you look at Iran's nuclear progress, this is 2008, the last year of the Bush administration. This is where President Obama came in, right here. And you can see that they were a little under 2,000 kilograms of enriched uranium. And now the number is closer to 9,000. This gap you see is the amount that they have converted into a different form in order to avoid going over that red line that Bibi Netanyahu so graphically set with his cartoon at the United Nations a year ago. And the rest of this shows you just a few of the things that the United States and the Israelis have done, sometimes together, often independently, to slow this process. So here you see the explosions at a couple of major facilities. These are cyber attacks, mostly from Olympic Games, the joint Israeli-U.S. Program to interrupt the enrichment of the uranium with the first real major state use of a cyber weapon, which I describe at significant length in Confront and Conceal. These are scientist assassinations, which the Americans tell us they had nothing to do with and the Israelis don't speak about. And these are sanctions. And if you, I'll skip past all of this. If you look to the sanctions, this is pretty interesting because Obama comes in right here, right around this spot. You can see crude oil exports in green and what's happened there. Oil export revenue and what's happened there. So it's fairly clear that these negotiations that are going on are probably related to the fact that this has begun to have a significant political effect. This is the real dollar exchange rate. And when you see it coming up lately, it's only when those negotiations looked like they were getting back in shape. This would be a significant argument for those who might say that the sanctions have to stay in effect in large part while the negotiations are underway, if you're going to keep the pressure on the leadership, particularly that internal conflict that's going on within Iran. There's an alternative argument that some make that you have to begin to lift them. But the more you lift them, the more you lower the incentive to negotiate. There's a really interesting debate underway that Americans and Israelis don't like to bring out into the fore about whether or not Iran is a rational actor, which would take you to the question of how they're going to act in these negotiations. Marty Dempsey, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, said last year, we're of the opinion that Iran is a rational actor, and you'll hear that from many American officials. Prime Minister Netanyahu said, I wouldn't rely on their rationality. Iran is guided by a leadership with an unbelievable fanaticism. And in fact, not everybody in Israel agrees with the prime minister on that. Meir Dagan, the former Mossad chief who was deeply involved in Olympic Games, has made the point that the regime is a rational regime, he thinks. They may not exactly be rational in what I call Western thinking, but they're considering all the implications. And you see some of these other former national security advisors and defense ministers making the same point. The last point I want to make, if we think that the way we're going to deal with this is by setting some red lines for the Iranians, our record on this is pretty poor. That, in fact, these are all red lines we have tried and retired in the past. We said that they couldn't put out a contract for a civilian nuclear reactor, they couldn't operate a conversion plant, they couldn't enrich to 5%, they couldn't master enrichment, they couldn't make a bomb's worth of 5% uranium. They've blown past each of these. And so hearing during the negotiations declarations of what can and cannot happen may be less than fully convincing to them. So I will leave it to greater minds here to tell us how we get out of this conundrum. But I just wanted to try to set it up by explaining that the problem today is significantly more difficult than the one the president inherited in 2009. And so any agreement to work couldn't really be just the same agreement that he could have gotten in 2009. Thanks very much.
How many of us can do that in 5 minutes? Incredible. I'd like to invite next Ambassador James Warlick, who's the special negotiator from the U.S. State Department for Nagorno-Karabakh and the U.S. chair of the Minsk group. And we're particularly happy to have Ambassador Warlick here, one, to talk about the regional implications of U.S.-Iranian relations, but also we're very happy that there is a U.S. co-chair of the Minsk group, and hopefully will be sometime soon at a conference here in Georgetown about the new peace agreements in the South Caucasus. So, Ambassador.
Thank you very much, Brenda. And thank you, Angela, and congratulations to Georgetown for organizing a conference that focuses on the South Caucasus. It's an area that deserves attention. Well, as Brenda said, I'm the U.S. co-chair for the OSCE Minsk group. My fellow co-chairs come from France and Russia. For those of you that follow Nagorno-Karabakh, even this very afternoon, someone came up to me and said, well, what did you do wrong to get that job? And many others will raise their eyebrows and say, good luck. I believe that we can find our way towards a settlement, and I believe that the Minsk group can help to facilitate that. First, just a few words about the conflict and about the region. Some people talk about Nagorno-Karabakh as a frozen conflict. It's not a frozen conflict. It might be a forgotten conflict, not forgotten in the region, certainly not in Armenia and Azerbaijan or elsewhere in the region where this is often at the top of everyone's priorities. But outside of the region, it is in fact a forgotten conflict, and it shouldn't be. It's in a state of, it's not frozen, it's in a state of neither peace nor war. And the situation on the ground is becoming more dangerous as time goes on. I was in Nagorno-Karabakh just a few weeks ago, and I had the opportunity to visit the line of contact. I was told when I was there that forces in some places along the line of contact are only 50 meters apart. The area where I was several hundred meters. And there is regular contact. There are injuries and deaths that come along that line of contact. And most frightening is both Armenia and Azerbaijan are improving and upgrading their military capabilities. If a war were to break out again, it would be a very serious one indeed. And there's an important regional dimension that we should care about. It wouldn't only be Armenia and Azerbaijan that would have deep concerns if there were violence. It would also be Russia, Turkey, and Iran. And certainly we can't today predict what role they might play if conflict were to break out again in Nagorno-Karabakh. We can be assured that those three countries would be very concerned about the instability that that would create in the South Caucasus. One of the reasons that people tell me good luck is because in 1994 there was a ceasefire, and since then negotiators have been trying to facilitate a negotiated settlement in Nagorno-Karabakh. You know, we've come close. The United States, here in Key West, came very close about a decade ago, and President Medvedev played the leading role a few years ago in Kazan, where we came very close to a settlement. When I took this job, it was the Secretary of State that approached me, and he said, I think we have a window of opportunity. And I said, yes, sir. He said, we need some creative thinking on the way forward. Will you take this job? And I said, yes, sir. And I wasn't quite sure then what the window of opportunity was, but there is a window of opportunity. Those of you who watched the Caucasus have seen its leadership. The Armenian president was just reelected a matter of months ago. He has a fresh mandate, and he has a long history with Nagorno-Karabakh. There are few people in Armenia that have the kind of credibility that President Sargsyan has. And as you know, President Aliyev in Azerbaijan was just reelected. And he does have a mandate. This is an important issue, not only for the people of Azerbaijan, but for President Aliyev personally. It's an issue that his father had wanted to solve when he was president. I have to say, this is a solvable conflict. We've come close. And I think if there is the political will, from all of the parties, we can find a way forward. The Minsk group has sometimes been criticized as no longer being relevant. What I found in my travels in the region is that all of the parties do very much consider the Minsk group relevant, and the United States will continue to work through the Minsk group to facilitate a negotiated settlement. That said, if there is a role for the United States that could help to facilitate a settlement, we stand ready. The real goal here is to bring the parties into comprehensive negotiations. It was the goal 20 years ago, and it is the goal today. As I talked to the leaders in the region, they said, and I take them at their word, that they want to enter into comprehensive negotiations, but the difficulty for all of the parties has been to find a way into those negotiations. I hope with this window of opportunity, we can see a renewed effort and a renewed interest to enter into a peace process that can look at a comprehensive settlement that can truly bring a new era of prosperity to the region. I have to say a word about one other set of issues that goes well beyond the negotiations themselves, and that is track two. If there is going to be a lasting settlement in Nagorno-Karabakh and between Azerbaijan and Armenia, there needs to be a level of trust and confidence that today does not exist. What we need to do, and we need to encourage all parties, is to work on security confidence building measures and people-to-people exchanges that can begin to build the kind of trust that will be necessary to continue a lasting peace into the future. So in addition to our efforts in the Minsk group to facilitate a peace process, we're very committed to working with all of the parties on track two and other measures that can help build trust between both countries. Thank you.
Okay, I'd like to call Dr. Stephen Blank, American Foreign Policy Council.
Thank you, Brenda. Thank you, Angela, for inviting me to this conference. I have the happy task of being the last speaker and speaking about Russia, which I'm sure everybody's entranced with these days, but I will try to shed some light on the doings of the bear and what the connections are between Russia, Iran, and the Caucasus. From Russia's point of view, and Iran is a major issue in Russian foreign policy, and you might think, if you just read the newspapers, that Russia and Iran are particularly close. The fact is that they aren't. Russia's view of the Iranian issue is wholly instrumental. That is, it intends to use Iran for purposes beyond the issues at hand. And the Iranians have a long-standing and well-founded suspicion of what the Russians are up to and don't trust them an inch. That goes both ways. But the point is that there are overlapping interests or connections and perceptions that bring them together. First of all, for Moscow, Iran is in the neighborhood. It will always be there. It is necessary, therefore, Iran and for Russia to have a relationship with Iran under all circumstances. Second, Russia firmly opposes Iran's getting a nuclear weapon. The problem is it is not clear what Russia is prepared to do to prevent them from getting a nuclear weapon. And we see the same thing with regard to Korea as well on the proliferation issue. This is because not only does Russia regard Iran as an eternal neighbor that has to be dealt with, it also believes that this eternal neighbor is a major actor in the Middle East. And therefore, it is not only somebody that has to be dealt with because it's there, but it has to be dealt with because of its capacities, which the Russians may tend to overinflate, but nonetheless regard as substantial. And therefore, we have to understand what the Middle East is for Russia. I would argue, and this becomes particularly clear with regard to Syria, that the overriding Russian objectives in the Middle East, from a geopolitical point of view, are twofold. One, to recover standing in the Middle East as an independent great power opposed to the United States, and B, as a corollary of, second, as a corollary there, to prevent the United States from, and the West from unilaterally consolidating any kind of order in the Middle East without Russia. Russia in the Middle East, if I may use Goethe's term, is an eternally negative actor or spirit. Ewiges Verneinigungsgeist, as Goethe calls it. Spirit that is constantly saying, no, we're not going to let you do this, at least not by yourself. And therefore, it is necessary for Russia, from its point of view, to have Iran in some sort of cooperative relationship with Moscow, even though Russia is perfectly prepared to sell Iran out if it will mean partnership with the United States and the West. And what's more, Tehran knows it. If you read the memoirs of Sayed Hossein Mousavian, which I was able to acquire as a freebie last Friday at a Carnegie conference, which was just lying in a cart, he was the head of Iran's foreign, I guess the equivalent of the National Security Council for many years. He makes it clear that the Iranians have a well-founded suspicion of Russia and vice versa, and that they know that Russia would sell Iran out if it meant that the U.S. and Russia could become partners in a real, genuine sense. That's not likely to happen, despite all the talk that we see this happening in Syria, because what we want and what the Russians want in Syria is antithetical. That's for another conference, though. Nonetheless, Russia sees Iran as a partner with Russia in blocking the United States in the Middle East, and what's more, not only in the Middle East, but potentially in the whole Caspian region, Central Asia, and the Caucasus. Indeed, three times Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov has stated that there is a necessity to have an international security conference for the Black Sea and that Iran should be there, which is quite a stretch if you think about where the Black Sea is and where Iran is. Nonetheless, one has to assume this is Russian policy. So the objectives are to prevent the U.S. from unilateral intervention in the Middle East, diplomatic, military, or otherwise, to consolidate a Middle Eastern coalition bringing together Iran, the new Iraq, and Syria, not coincidentally, either a Shiite coalition or in a coalition of what we might call outcast Sunnis, if you want to call that, and surprisingly, The same at coalition that we saw in 1978-79, when I was young, the rejectionist front, which was opposed to Camp David Accords between the United States and Egypt, and which many of us thought at the time was the brainchild of Yevgeny Primakov. And I suspect he is still consulting, I know he's still consulting for the government on, and active on Middle East policy. It's not surprising that the Middle East policy reflects, I think, his ideas, if not his imprint. Beyond that, it's important for the United, for Russia to prevent the United States from successfully promoting democracy abroad on general principles, and secondly, because it's contagious and could spread to Russia as well as Central Asia and the Caucasus. And critically, it is essential for Russia to prevent Iran from becoming a major partner of Europe, because if Iran became a major partner of Europe, Iranian energy would go to Europe and would undermine Russian energy. 11 years ago, Khodorkovsky spoke at Carnegie. I don't know if you were there. You were there. And he mentioned that Iranian oil was better quality than Russian oil. So obviously, from a man who knows and knew, Russia has to get rid of that partnership. Finally, in the Caucasus and Central Asia, because my time is running out, Russia is determined to prevent Azerbaijan from challenging Azerbaijan or blocking the Caspian, but so far has been unable to succeed. Nonetheless, Iran in the Caspian is a very dangerous actor, particularly with regard to Azerbaijan. There were three or four attempts last year that the Azeris broke up to undermine the Azeri state through gun running, Shiite incitement, and plots against Azerbaijan and Israelis resident in Azerbaijan. And therefore, there is really no love lost between Iran and Azerbaijan. A better tie between Georgia, obviously for reasons we've heard it with Armenia, but Russia suspects Iranian ambitions in Central Asia and the Caucasus. And outside of these plots against Azerbaijan, Iran has been remarkably cautious in doing anything to antagonize Russia. But there's no guarantee that would end. Thank you.
Okay, for the task of tying this all together, U.S.-Iranian relations, U.S.-Russian relations, implications of this triangle, implications of U.S.-Iranian relations for U.S. allies in or countries in general in the South Caucasus and in general for U.S. allies. So, Professor Stent.
I am indeed. Thank you very much, Brenda. I am indeed the very last speaker, and we've had a very rich discussion, so I can't possibly summarize all of it. I do want to thank you very much. Brenda Shaffer came to me with the idea for this conference a few months ago, and my first reaction was Iran, South Caucasus, what's the connection? I've learned an enormous amount today, and in thinking about all of this, I've learned a lot. So again, thank you very much. We've opened a very interesting dialogue here. So I'm supposed to talk about Iran and the South Caucasus as an issue in U.S.-Russian relations. And of course, the first thing I thought about is, usually in U.S.-Russian relations, these are two very discrete issues, sets of talks, one on Iran and one, to some extent, on the South Caucasus. I will try, and unfortunately, when I do tie them together at the end, it's going to be in a rather pessimistic way, but I will come back to that. I would just like to reinforce something that Steve Blank said, which is from the Russian point of view, if you look at Iran on the one hand and the South Caucasus on the other, it brings together the two major strands in Russian foreign policy under Putin, and particularly it's very much on display now. The first one is Russia has the right to a seat at the table for every major international issue, and it has an equal right to that of the United States to try and determine the outcome of these issues, and you can see that very much in Syria at the moment, but of course in Iran too. And the second major goal under Putin, and again, it's very much on display now, and we've heard some of it, is to make sure there is no further encroachment of Euro-Atlantic institutions into the post-Soviet space. And as we've heard already, that's equally true now for the European Union as it is for NATO. Russia is very concerned, as we've heard, about the EU possibly signing association or initialing association agreements with various post-Soviet states, including those in the South Caucasus. So just 2 seconds now, or 2 minutes, on the U.S.-Russian relationship. I've just finished a book on U.S.-Russian relations over the last 20 years, where I count up to 4 resets from the U.S. side. Each president has begun rather optimistically, and it hasn't ended that well. In the Clinton and Bush administrations, the deterioration happened very much in the second administration. I would say we're now at a point, and the White House themselves have really said that reset is over, and we're in the period of a pause now. But if you look at what worked in the reset in the first Obama administration, in fact, Iran was one of the major successes, counted as such by the White House. That is to say, we did get the Russians to agree to tougher sanctions on Iran, even though somewhat reluctantly, but they did, after we showed them evidence of some of the clandestine things that were going on there. And they at least canceled at that point the contract for the sale of the S-300s to Iran. So again, Iran was seen as an area of greater U.S. Russian cooperation, and I would argue still is today. Now, if you look at the South Caucasus, it's a somewhat different story, and I would say the reason why that issue became less of a problem between the U.S. and Russia, and I'm talking now after the Russia-Georgia war, which of course was the very, very low point of U.S.-Russian relations in the post-Soviet period, was because, in fact, in my opinion, the U.S. administration, the Obama administration, took a step back and somewhat distanced itself, particularly, I'm talking about Georgia now, not so much for Armenia and Azerbaijan, but certainly, you know, revisited this issue, took a step back, and therefore it became less of an issue because of U.S. policy, not because of anything that the Russians did. But that was one of the reasons, at least from the administration's point of view, why the reset worked, was because the Russia's neighborhood became less of an issue between the U.S. and Russia. Okay, well now, as we've heard, we're in a period of a pause. President Obama's talked about a pause, and in U.S.-Russian relations, every day there are more revelations from Mr. Snowden, which are having a pretty bad effect on the U.S.'s relations now with its allies. And so for various reasons, we had, of course, the cancellation of the summit by President Obama, the first time since Nikita Khrushchev canceled the summit, that you had a U.S.-Russian summit canceled. So we're in the period of a pause now. But the U.S. is fated to interact with Russia. There's a limit to how much the pause, you know, how widespread the pause can be, because, of course, we are now working together in Syria. Russia was able to take the initiative, for reasons we don't need to go into now, in proposing this series of negotiations on disarming Syria in terms of its chemical weapons, and we still have discussions going on a possible conference in Geneva to negotiate an end to the civil war, although I would be very cautious about whether that's actually going to happen or not. So it's important to remember that in this relationship between Moscow and Washington, it's always compartmented, and there are parts of it that don't work, and then there are other parts which do work either less well or better, whatever, because we have to interact with Russia. Without working with Russia, we can't resolve some of these issues. So a couple of more words now about the current negotiations with Iran. As far as I can see, for the moment, Russia has welcomed this opening between the United States and Iran, and the possibility that there will be some agreement, because Russia does not want there to be any kind of military attack on Iran. Why? Because it fears, first of all, instability in the neighborhood that such an attack, a military attack, might cause, and then particularly, and we've already heard about this, the domestic impact within Russia, within the rest of North Caucasus, other Islamic parts of Russia that would be adversely affected by that. And the other side of that is Russia is always aware in its dealings with Iran that Iran could make mischief within the Russian Federation, could cause instability there, and it wants to keep that kind of potential at bay. So far, I think it's welcomed these negotiations and has even now proposed a total lifting of all sanctions and placing the Iranian nuclear program under international control. I don't think, as we've heard, the U.S. Congress would certainly not go along with the idea of removing all sanctions very soon. There are some more skeptical skeptical people who say, ah, what the however much the Russians may now support U.S.-Iranian and P5 plus one negotiations, if there was really a prospect of a blossoming, of a flowering of the U.S.-Iranian relationship and things were to change, this in fact could be to Russia's detriment, both for reasons of energy and trade that we've heard about, and because the U.S. might then replace Russia as a major power in terms of Iran. I would think we're a very long way away from that, so I think at the moment we should just focus on the fact that on the Iranian question, U.S. and Russian interests at the moment seem to be more aligned. And then that finally leads me to come back to the South Caucasus and where we are today in terms of the U.S.-Russian relationship. We've heard about, obviously, we support, if it's possible, to have a solution to the Nagorno-Karabakh problem, and we're very glad you have this position now and that you've embarked on this complex series of negotiations, so I'm not going to talk about that. Obviously, the U.S., and we've heard about that as well, was a major supporter in the 90s of having alternative energy routes in the South Caucasus, the BTC pipeline. I'll just give you one quote from my former and current colleague, Madeleine Albright, who said at the time, we don't want to wake up 10 years from now and have all of us ask ourselves why in the world we made a mistake and didn't build that pipeline. Well, the pipeline got built. There is an alternative route. Of course, one of the implications of that now is Russia wants to make sure that no similar pipeline could ever get built again, but at least that one was built. So I will finally then come back to the question of Georgia. Obviously, the United States and its European allies support Georgia's territorial integrity, and they're not going to recognize South Ossetia and Abkhazia in the way that Russia did or wanted other countries to do in the beginning, although I'm not sure that that's very important for Russia anymore. The U.S. has looked, you know, with interest and concern at domestic developments within Georgia in the last year. I mean, the current election, is Kenny Alowitz still there? I can't see him. you are. All right, you were an observer at the election. You could maybe talk about that, but with the election that's just taken place and then what happened last year, and there is, there's interest, there's concern, and there's, you know, an encouragement of Georgia to continue developing along a more transparent economic and political path and to consolidate institutions of, again, market and democratic institutions. That is a major concern. And I guess another concern for the U.S. right now is looking at the situation of that Georgia and the European Union are in. That is to say, can we expect Georgia in the next month to initial a preliminary agreement that would lead towards association with the European Union? We've heard already about what Armenia chose to do. I'm not going to go over that again, but there is clearly interest in this, and then concern if this doesn't happen, what path does Georgia then take? But the final point, and this is where I do come back to something basically that Svante Cornell said this morning, and if you look, if you try and tie the Iranian, if you like, and the South Caucasus issues together. And that's, of course, the impending withdrawal from Afghanistan. So as 2014 looms very quickly ahead of us, and you have a NATO withdrawal from the region, obviously it's not going to be a complete withdrawal immediately, but the trend is certainly in the direction that there will be a withdrawal, and it is inevitable, given all the things we've heard today and given all the challenges that the United States certainly faces in terms of foreign policy and the weariness within the United States of our population about too many foreign entanglements, and particularly ones that imply military presence. I think it's inevitable that you will get a lessening of a presence in this region, and I mean the Caspian region and also the South Caucasus, just because there are too many other demands, certainly in terms of the U.S. on U.S. energies and focus in terms of foreign policy. And that obviously raises the question of Russia and what it considers to be its sphere of privileged interests. And we know that President Putin is trying to create this Eurasian Union. We don't know how that's, how that's going. Again, we await the results of the Vilnius summit in terms of the region's relationship with the European Union. But it is, you know, there will be an asymmetry there if you have less U.S. attention, and Russian attention is not going to lessen. How you deal with that is very difficult. You then come back to the states of the South Caucasus themselves, and they obviously have to do whatever they can to create conditions on the ground that bolster their own sovereignty. But as we've heard today, I think that's a very difficult challenge. So I think that means that we need to have more conferences on this to discuss other angles.
Great. Okay. Thank you very much. Definitely provocative panel. So we're going to open it up to questions and comments. So we have a half hour, so it should give us time for a rich discussion. If I may, I'd like to throw the first question to David. David, your paper ran yesterday an editorial board piece on the meaning of the U.S. should move forward with Iran, but carefully with its allies. I'm hearing from, whether it's from Ankara, from Jerusalem, and from Saudi Arabia, that they're concerned about not informing them. Here today in the conference, we heard the same thing from allies in the South Caucasus and around the region. How can the U.S. move forward better with its allies as it moves with this relationship with Tehran?
It's complex, and I would say that the complexity of it has sort of two or three different elements. The first is this administration would like these negotiations to go on in private behind closed doors because they're afraid that if the details of the negotiations get out, constituencies on all sides will begin to line up against the concessions. And I fully understand that. You could imagine that if word got out that the Iranians were freezing or dismantling a big part of their nuclear program, if they had agreed to turn over some of the information that the UN inspectors have been demanding for 3 or 4 years on weaponization, which goes to the most sensitive part of this, that you could see big objections from the Iranian Revolutionary Guard and so forth. On the other hand, if the U.S. is in the position of beginning to discuss lifting some sanctions, they're going to hear it from a lot of people in the U.S. Congress who voted for those sanctions, and voting for sanctions against Iran is a lot easier than voting to lift them. They're going to hear it from Saudis and Israelis and others in the Middle East who believe the administration is being taken for a ride here and will give up too much, and that all of the Iranians are trying to do is get sanctions lifted and have enough time and space to build on in the program. So to them, secrecy is important. What runs against that is that when you inform your allies and you inform members of Congress, you can frequently measure the time to the leaks of what is happening, or selective leaks of what is happening, in milliseconds. I'm not objecting to this. I'm just stating it as a fact. Okay. And they've got an inform people versus secrecy problem. The second level of problem, I think, that they have is that you don't have a deal at all until you have a total deal. And so once the total deal comes out, the big fear that the Israelis, the Saudis, I bet even the Russians have about this, is it will be presented to them as sort of a fait accompli, that they're not going to have a voice in it. And so it's one thing to consult allies. It's another thing to consult allies with the thought that they're actually going to play a role.
Okay. Please identify yourself. Okay.
Hello, I'm David Leonardo, independent researcher. This question is for Ambassador Warlick. First of all, good luck with your work. How do you respond to the characterization that the Minsk group has become somewhat of a scapegoat for the governments of Azerbaijan and Armenia, allowing them to sidestep responsibility for the lack of a peace agreement and blaming the international community for this lack of an agreement? Thank you.
I wouldn't use the word scapegoat, but it is true that if there's going to be a negotiated settlement, there has to be the political will to get there, and there has to be recognition on all sides that compromises will be necessary. The problem isn't the format. The Minsk group, in fact, as I said, is widely accepted in the region, and I've met with the presidents myself who do turn to the Minsk group to help to facilitate a way forward. The real question is political will, and are the presidents prepared to take the kinds of decisions that will be necessary first to enter into comprehensive negotiations and then to reach a settlement that is desperately needed in the region. I am convinced in working with my co-chairs that this is an area where the U.S., Russia, and France can work together. In fact, if we're looking for areas in the U.S.-Russian relationship where we have cooperated effectively and worked together, and I believe we will continue to do so, it is Nagorno-Karabakh.
Okay. And my question has to do with how anybody on the panel who cares to comment on it sees the role of the opening of a U.S. diplomatic post in Iran, whether any such notion would have to wait for some kind of a successful conclusion to these very complex nuclear negotiations, or whether you think the separate attempt to open such an American presence in Iran would positively affect current and upcoming Iranian nuclear negotiations. Thank you.
David.
Take a quick shot at that. This was actually discussed at the end of the last few years of the Bush administration, where they took up the question. I think, you know, in the State Department, they were nervous about it for many reasons, including the fact that memories of the hostage situation are not exactly gone at this point. And I think the Iranians were a little bit nervous about it as well, because I think they were quite concerned about how well they could sort of control the security, given the fact that there's a pretty factionalized view within Iran about the wisdom of this. So, you know, you still have a portion of the Iranian government that wants to, for propaganda purposes or whatever their own purposes are, use the Great Satan lines, of which anything that you opened would become the centerpiece location for these protests. And you have those who think you need to go build something up. I could very easily see this, though, as a significant interim move within the negotiations if they were making some progress. And I don't know that it has been discussed, but I can't imagine that that it hasn't been.
Okay, Alex.
Alex Peterson from the Woodrow Wilson Center. Thanks very much, Ambassador Warlick, for your comments. I'm glad to hear you say that there is a window of opportunity for us to move towards conflict settlement on Nagorno-Karabakh. I wonder if you might elaborate a little bit on what are the strategic dividends for the United States in achieving conflict settlement, and I mean that regionally, not just with Armenia and Azerbaijan. What are the dividends that could be seen in the wider South Caucasus with our, in terms of our relationship with Russia, in terms of our relationship with Iran even? Thanks very much.
Well, I would say we have wide-ranging interests in the region which aren't entirely recognized. We have, certainly with Turkey and Russia, I don't need to elaborate on the very complex relationships we have with both countries which would be affected by our ability to negotiate a settlement on Nagorno-Karabakh, but also with Armenia and Azerbaijan. With Armenia, we're developing an increasingly closer, wide-ranging relationship. You'll see this in coming weeks as we launch a U.S.-Armenia joint task force, which should be meeting here in Washington, which is going to talk about a wide range of issues, including trade and investment, going beyond the more traditional issues in the relationship. Similarly, with Azerbaijan, We do have interests in the energy sector, but increasingly our interests, our work with the Azerbaijanis is more wide-ranging, and we want to emphasize that. It's clear that for future peace, prosperity, growth in the region, Nagorno-Karabakh stands in the way of that, and we do have an interest in helping to facilitate a resolution.
Okay. In the meantime, okay, let's take in the meantime back there.
Question to Ambassador Warlick. You just mentioned wide-ranging interest with Azerbaijan energy aside, and we've been, I mean the U.S. interests, and we've been hearing pretty much most of the day today how the U.S. interest in the region is diminishing, and how even the appointment of someone in your current role, the fact that it took so long, sort of demonstrates that there isn't a sufficient U.S. interest in the region. So in that regard, how would you describe those wide-ranging interests, and also how do you see your own work in your new appointment in the situation where the U.S. interest is apparently diminishing in the region? Thank you.
Well, I would say just specifically on Nagorno-Karabakh in the absence of a full-time negotiator, the Russians, President Medvedev, came very close to reaching agreement in Kazan about 2 years ago. And I think over the past 2 years, we've been really waiting to see where continuing negotiations can go. With this window of opportunity, we believe that there is an opportunity to take advantage of that, and together with the Minsk group, I hope we can do that. And I hope that there will be the will, not only by the presidents, as I've said, but among the people of both countries, to move forward and finally end this conflict. More broadly speaking, certainly we in the State Department and U.S. government do not believe that we are moving away from our interests in the South Caucasus. Clearly, we've been very close friends with Georgia, and we want to continue that relationship, and we're very encouraged by the elections that just took place. And similarly, as I just said, in Armenia and Azerbaijan, we're looking at wide-ranging sets of issues that will bring us together for more comprehensive discussions. We want to build on those relationships. I think it is a misperception to conclude that this is a zero-sum game. Somehow, because the Russians are taking more of an interest, the U.S. must be taking less of an interest. That's not the case. We believe that we do have, and can continue to have, a very productive relationships with those countries.
Ambassador Yalowitz.
Question for David Sanger, if I could. Angela and others have spoken very, I think, effectively about Mr. Putin and his ideas of, you know, Russia being a great power again, of the Eurasian, you know, power bloc. Obviously, the Iranians and their decision to move forward are affected greatly by the sanctions, but I'm wondering whether you see any indications on the Iranian side of perhaps the U.S., you know, as a declining power, as the Russians, you know, are alleging right now, and whether or not that's any factor in their thinking. You know, it was outlined that there's sort of two blocks now in Iran in terms of thinking how to go forward, and I'm wondering whether or not that's a factor in their thinking at all.
Look, two blocks would be a vast oversimplification. I mean, we're talking about Iranian politics here, and so I wouldn't do that. I think that the strain of questions about whether or not the United States is a retreating power in the Middle East extends far beyond the Iranians, and they're reading the same things you are. I watched on Charlie Rose last night as Dick Cheney, as he's on his Heart book tour, made the argument that pulling an additional carrier out of the region was a major mistake and a bad signal to the Iranians. Certainly, they're looking very carefully at what we do with the Fifth Fleet in Bahrain. And they're constantly measuring the question, I think, of what kinds of actions they could or could not take without the U.S. getting involved. And there, the U.S., of course, is using the threat that Israel might act by itself to its own purposes in this regard. But I'm sure they're certain of two things. I'm sure they're probably certain that the Syria incident, the president's decision not to go strike Syria for the use of chemical weapons, revealed a strain in American politics of let's stay out of the region and future conflicts. And I think they're also quite convinced that if they did get into a future conflict with the United States and it was full scale, they would lose the nuclear infrastructure and a lot more very, very quickly. So the question is, how big a gamble do they want to take? And how much tolerance do they think the United States has for dragging on the talks?
So if I could just follow up there, bringing it into the region here, the number of points were made during the day that would then from Tehran's perspective, is this a good time for monkey business in Bahrain, for instance, or Azerbaijan, and trying to destabilize these U.S. allies while they're talking to the Americans?
Well, again, it's a question of who in Tehran we're talking about. And, you know, the Quds Force has been very active, obviously, in Syria, active in Iraq, and could well consider this a good time to do something elsewhere, particularly if there are some in Iran who wanted to scuttle the negotiations. Mm-hmm. You know, it would not be hard to stage an incident, even a cyber attack, of which we've seen several. Think of the one on Saudi Arabia that took place a year ago that took out the Saudi Aramco computers that would help scuttle this. So, you know, to get to this negotiation, you need to do three negotiations. Okay, there's the U.S. and, of course, European allies and Iran. There's a negotiation here at home about lifting the sanctions. And there's a negotiation inside Iran about how much of the program they're willing to give up. And the trick here is that all three of those have to somehow come together.
Questions, comments? Okay.
Thank you. I'm Candice Leomanda from the Embassy of Azerbaijan. Mr. Ambassador, I would like to ask my question not as a diplomat or foreign service officer. I would rather to ask my question as an internally displaced person. So I'm from the region that is under occupation of Republic of Armenia. So I am from Jabrail. My question, as you mentioned in your speech, confidence building is a major step in the settlement of conflict. How do you think, would it be possible to make any confidence building if there is no Azerbaijani living in Nagorno-Karabakh? Thank you.
Just a brief comment on the situation of internally displaced persons. It's one that we've been concerned about, the international community has been concerned about for some time. I had an opportunity on my visit to Nagorno-Karabakh to visit the surrounding territories, and this is one of the most important reasons why we need to work towards a negotiated settlement. It shouldn't be as hard as it is to have confidence-building measures and people-to-people programs between Azerbaijan and Armenia, including for those people who are living in Nagorno-Karabakh. But in fact, it is difficult. I've taken this issue up with both President Sargsyan and President Aliyev, and I challenged them, together with my co-chairs, to find a way to undertake the kinds of steps that will be necessary to ensure a peace, and that both Azerbaijanis and Armenians can live together in peace and prosperity. This is a huge challenge. It's one of the challenges that I had not perceived when I took the job to be as hard as it is. One way forward is not to rely on either government to be taking these initiatives by themselves, but for civil society to be involved and to stand up and to say there is a way forward, and we do need this kind of people-to-people exchange and this kind of confidence building. I believe it will be extremely important for both countries for the future.
Do we have a mic here?
Thank you for the great presentation. I'm Gabriel Balayan, legal scholar at the Library of Congress, Fulbright scholar. And actually, my question to the ambassador, about a year ago, a bit more than a year ago, the breakdown point for the president meeting of Armenia and Azerbaijan was the Safarov case. And as a person who met three presidents, the Karabakh president, Armenian president, and Azerbaijani president, on the people's level, Armenian people is not so willing to continue the process negotiation with this case, having in mind. Do you see the will with the president to continue this negotiation process with this case open on the international level and on the national levels as well? Thank you.
I think it's worth your taking just 20 seconds to explain what that case is. Would you like to explain?
Yeah, sure. Actually, there was a case which happened about 2004. It was in Hungary, Budapest, and the Armenian officer, military officer, was killed by axe by the Azerbaijani military officer. It was a NATO training, and Hungarian authorities convicted him for the life sentence.
Okay, then, it's supposed to be a question, not a...
Just Ambassador Warlick asked me to explain the case. Uh-huh. And they extradited Safarov about late August last year. He was entered in the country as a hero, as he was treated as a hero and continuing to be treated. And that was the point which outraged all the, international society as well, not only Armenians. Thank you.
The Safarov case does undermine confidence. I think we need to move beyond Safarov. We can't let that affect future willingness by all parties to identify confidence building measures, continue with exchange programs, find ways for civil society to interact with each other. I would expect that there will be incidents in the future. I hope not as grave as Safarov, but there will be instances that undermine confidence and trust between the countries, and that's all the more reason that we need to work on track two programs.
Mr. Ambassador, I don't think that, I'm Natik Basho from the Embassy of Azerbaijan. I don't think that you are not aware of the Safarov case. As a co-chair, you know the details, and I don't see any ground to raise such a kind of things in Iran and the Caucasus topic today. So if we are going in details
things... we're talking here on the level of Tehran, Washington, Baku, Yerevan.
I see... some circles are interested in opening such a kind of questions here. That's what. Could you comment on the military persons in that? I want to say the separatists in Nagorno-Karabakh that threatened Azerbaijan, including the Armenian military persons threatened Azerbaijan to hit Azerbaijan's infrastructure. And they're doing military exercises only for these purposes. Could you comment on this matter? Thank you.
Well, I think just by way of explanation for the Safarov case, it was directly relevant to track two, and your question is as well. There are incidents that occur on the line of contact. I saw for myself the dangers that are there, and there are snipers on both sides of the conflict. And I believe that that problem needs to be addressed, and a part of track two is a willingness of all parties to move forward with confidence-building measures, and to date the parties have not been able to do so. I hope that all the parties will be willing to work with the co-chairs on a way forward on these track two initiatives.
Okay, last question, Charles. Charles.
I've been trying to find a common thread to these various issues. Charles Perkins. Diplomacy. We're talking about two distinct, yet I think in many ways overlapping diplomatic processes, and I'm wondering if anyone on the panel can talk about potential lessons learned between the two sides. You know, as I see it, there's common elements where large powers are trying to find a diplomatic solution. I'm personally skeptical that either process will be successful without some very careful carrots and sticks. But both of them are situations where there is great potential for regional conflict if there's a failure. And historically, there has always been the trap of letting talks drag on too long, having a bad agreement, which actually may be worse than no agreement. Would anybody like to posit just in theoretical terms about the nature of the diplomatic processes and resolving conflicts using either or both of these as examples?
Well, we could be here all evening doing that, you know. But the diplomatic process in resolving these two conflicts is very different. There are certain lessons that I think we all know apply to negotiations in general, whatever the nature of the issue or whoever the parties are. But the Nagorno-Karabakh issue is at root a conflict between two relatively small states, Armenia and Azerbaijan, in which larger states have substantial regional and international interests. The Iranian case is a much more global situation, because what's at stake in the Iranian case is not just the security of Iran, it's the nuclear nonproliferation treaty and regime as a whole. So whatever happens with regard to Iran, for example, has reverberations for North Korea, India, Pakistan, and perhaps other countries in the Middle East, particularly if Iran does get a nuclear weapon, because even several years ago, there were 13 states in the Middle East that either had or wanted a reactor. If Iran goes nuclear, many more will either go beyond that or at least want a reactor. So there is that. The Iranian case also is, from the Iranian point of view, is a large power challenging a smaller one, which is not the case at heart in the Nagorno-Karabakh issue. So there are important negotiating lessons in terms of the general principle of negotiation that, you know, you don't box your opponent or your adversary into a corner, that there has to be a give and take on both sides, that you have to pay attention to domestic lobbies in all the parties' countries. But those are generic negotiating principles. I'm not sure that there are necessarily that many issues in common between these two.
I'm going to give the panelists one last round of comments. So, David?
The only thing I would add to that is the Iran conflict over the nuclear program, at least, is one, if you ask people in the administration, of core national interest. And I'm not sure that I would say that necessarily about the other conflict that we've been dealing with here. It's certainly of great importance, and certainly for regional stability of great importance, but it doesn't rise in the American decision-making process to a level of core national interest, which puts in a whole different set of factors, as I think Steve indicated.
Ambassador Warlick, final comments?
I agree with both of my colleagues, but would just make the point that Nagorno-Karabakh should not be a forgotten conflict.
Okay, Professor Stent?
Well, I will just say that, I mean, I agree with everything that everybody said. Obviously, the Iran issue has a greater urgency because we have the prospect of serious military action that could be taken if there isn't some resolution. There could also be military action, clearly, in the Nagorno-Karabakh case, too. But the repercussions of military action in Iran would be much greater. That doesn't mean that the other conflict isn't important, too. Okay, so I'm just going to close this now. I wanted to thank, did Eugene just disappear? All right, I would like to thank Eugene Imus and Christina Watts, who I think is still out there, for all the work they did to help organize this conference. Thank you very much. And again, I'd like to thank Brenda for coming to me with this idea, and this is hopefully the first in a series of different conferences, and to thank you all for coming. Thank you.